This special extra Runde with your hosts Ron and Hendrik.
It's Friday, Hendrik, and we are back with another special episode.
Yes.
The second special episode in a row. Crazy, right?
Yes. I think it's tough to top the last special episode with Johannes Denisbø, but today we have Vetle's Jorstar Christiansen in our show.
Yeah, now, Hendrik, I don't know if you pronounce his name right. I think it's Jorstar.
Jorstar.
Jorstar, as he told us. Not so easy, especially his second name, but yeah, apart from that, he's the biggest Norwegian, right? At least in body size and weight. But of course, also very successful in biathlon.
Yes, for sure. He is a gold medal winner in Beijing. He also grabbed the bronze in the Mustard there. And until this point in time, he got 3 individual World Cup victories.
Yeah, and when you know us, you know that we will start with his early beginnings in biathlon. And Vetle has a very interesting story because after being very strong in his junior years, he got sick and that threw him out for quite some years. It was a pretty tough time for him. And of course, we wanted to know how he managed to get out of that crisis and come back as we know him today.
Yeah, because today we know he came back stronger than ever before. So what are his goals for this season after being 4th in the overall last year? And why did he kept on doing biathlon in his toughest time as an athlete?
Yeah, that's a good question. And as we know him, he's an ice cold killer when it comes to last shooting duels. So what's his mental strategy there and why is Vetle so good in those situations? I think that's something that every athlete wants to have, that he's super calm in the last shooting duels, especially when the gold is on the line, Hendrik.
Yeah, that's a good point. This also includes the crazy Olympic relay from Beijing. So stay tuned and let's go.
Yeah, let's go. So let's welcome Vetle's Jorstar Christiansen.
Thank you very much.
Has that been a good pronunciation of your name?
Yeah, it was the best pronunciation I've heard from a German guy.
So, oh, wow.
Very, very good. It's not so easy to say this letter O. And we have it in Norwegian vocabulary. So pretty good, I would say.
Okay. Vetle, only 6 more days to go until the new World Cup season starts for you. And tell us, where are you at the moment? I think it's a little bit too early for Kontiolahti, right?
Yeah, it's a bit too early for Kontiolahti. Right now we are searching for the snow in Norway. So we decided to go to Beitostølen in the Norwegian mountains for the second time this month. It's been pretty warm as well here up north. So Beitostølen is the best place to be. So we stay here for this week and then we travel to Kontiolahti Saturday morning.
Okay, that's late or not?
Yeah, we like to don't have too much time to get nervous before the first World Cup. So we decided we need always just 2 training days and we're good to go.
And how nervous are you at this point in time right now?
I would say I guess I'm not the guy that gets very nervous before the races, and I mean I just have to trust the training I've done and try to just relax about the competitions. If I did a good enough job, then it will be easy. But if I did a bad job, it will be pretty tough. But I trust in myself that I've trained well enough for this season, so I'm pretty calm.
Sounds good. But Vetle, before we talk about the upcoming season, let's jump back to your beginnings in biathlon, or even before that, to your origin. How did you become a biathlete?
I think I started biathlon when I was about 8 years old, pretty early, I would say. But originally I was doing alpine skiing because my father, he was running the ski lifts at my home place. And I was literally born at this cafeteria in the bottom of the ski slopes. So my older sister, she was doing alpine skiing. So I grew up watching her and Axel Lund Svindal training in those slopes. So of course that motivated me to to do alpine skiing. But I wasn't that talented, I think. And by luck, I was joining a friend of mine home from school after school one day, and he was doing biathlon. So he was going to training, and of course, I had to follow him. My mom and dad, they were working, so I had to join him for training. And since that day, it's been all about biathlon. I mean, I combined it for maybe 3 or 4 years, alpine skiing and biathlon. But since the age of 12, I think it was mostly about biathlon and cross country.
So nearly your whole life, man. That's a long time that you're a biathlete.
Yeah, nearly my whole life.
Bentley, we saw that you were quite decorated after your youth years. You won 6 medals out of 7 youth world championship races. So I think that's an impressive start to a career. But do you remember your thoughts on your career, how you would progress after your years as a youth biathlete?
Yeah, I think Johannes and myself, we followed each other pretty closely during our youth and junior years.
Yeah,
I mean, we were both at home in Norway and at these international championships. We were mostly winning or at least taking home some top 3 places or medals. So we would be like, we call a child star in our young ages. We were used to doing good, but then it around the age of 20-21, I mean, his career really turned up, and he really quickly became, I mean, the best, one of the best in the world. And I struggled a bit more. I had a year like totally off training because of some illness. We really couldn't figure out what it was. I couldn't train for like almost a year, and I slowly had to work my way back to normal training and to competition and stuff like that. But I remember that I was, of course, when you get hit by a sickness like this, you get some thoughts, should I continue or should I find something else to do? Life is more than biathlon, I guess. I felt pretty good at school, so like, okay, I can take some subjects and be good at another thing in life. But I mean, my inner motivation said that it's something I haven't showed yet. I can do more than I have done so far. So I decided to keep going, and I think the work paid off.
Yeah,
luckily.
Yeah. And if we also look back to your World Cup debut, you were also just 20 years of age, and that was in December 2012 in Östersund. So nearly 10 years ago now, and you had a pretty good result for a first time, I think. Your first 4 races, you ended on a 27th, 23rd, 15th and a 21st rank, and you reached your first podium with the win in the relay, but then you got dropped out of the team again. So what happened here in 2012, Vettle?
Yeah, I remember it very well. Actually, we had a quiz with our TV broadcaster here the other day, so I know that my first World Cup race was the 1st of December, I guess, in Östersund. Uh-huh. At least he told me. I also remember I missed my first shot at the World Cup, so it was a bad start of the shooting, but I got some quite good results at the age of 20. And of course, the highlight with this relay in Hochfilzen, where we had only Ole Einar from the A team going this relay, and me, Lars Helge Birkeland and Henrik Labelund competing for the B team. Yeah. And we managed to win with only 1 spear bullet, so it was
crazy.
Quite an experience for a 20-year-old child, I would say. yeah, but I mean, the rest of that 2012 season, the Norwegian Federation, they didn't want to rush me like to compete in all the World Cups or all the IBU Cups. They wanted to take it really slowly. So we did some junior world championship, of course, and some European championships for juniors in Ossebly. I think was the year. And after that, the sickness arrived. It was the upcoming or the season after, if I'm not wrong, or maybe the next one, but at least in the same period, it was some, the federation want to match us very slowly with the best in the world. So they didn't want us to rush out in the World Cup. But at the same time, I got this, I think it was just starting with a light flu, but it expanded and I wasn't the best to take care of my body. And you're young, you want just to train and train and train to become the best in the world. And you don't want to rest, and I didn't rest even if I was sick. So yeah, it affected me a lot more than I could imagine, and it took a long way to get back. I also decided to, when I wanted to build myself up again and train, I wanted to do it more in my own speed. Like, I didn't want to be together with a team and look at the other guys, how fast they were, and maybe be a little bit dragged into their tempo and their speed on training. I wanted to keep very calm and just from being very bad at listening to my body, I became very, very good almost overnight when I was doing this recovery back to the world. So I said, no, I don't want to be in the A team. I don't want to be in the B team. I want to go with this private team, which they had some good friends of mine there, athletes, and some athletes matching more my level at that point, so I could slowly get back to the fitness I needed for the World Cup. And it took some years. It was to get back in competition shape was not easy, but it was not the worst part. But to get back in the same rhythm for training and to do the same hours you were used to with the same speed you were used to, it was it took 2.5 years, I guess. So it was a long and painful way back, but I think it was worth doing it this way, because then I could I can have my best years now when I'm turning 30 and getting older.
But did you never thought about quitting at that time where you had those troubles for such a long time also?
Yeah, it was, people close to me and my friends, they told me, maybe you should think about quitting, because you're such an intelligent guy, you can be successful in school, in work, you can I'm really interested in economy and working with numbers and money and stuff like that, so you can be very good at this and earn a good money. But I felt from my heart that I know I can do better in biathlon than I have done already, so I choose to go not the wrong way, but the harder, the tough way, because it's something inside me that still has to break out. It's some last loops, it's some last shootings I still haven't shown the world. So that was like the only my inner motivation told me to keep going. And today, I can say I'm glad I listened to my heart and not to my head, in at least in this case.
And is it also your junior and youth years that made you keep on going? Because I think the Norwegian male team is so strong. And also, there are so many guys that are trying to get into the A team. And so you had those good years in your juniors, and that helped you to keep holding the motivation to do biathlon?
Yeah, for sure. Because, I already felt like I felt success. I felt the feeling of winning in the junior ages, and I knew what that feeling gave me, and I didn't want to let that feeling go. Of course, you can get this adrenaline, this kick, this feeling from another type of work, but for me, it was all about the feeling, the adrenaline of being on top, and
yeah.
I knew I had been good in the junior age, so why couldn't I be good in the senior age? I believed in myself and I wanted to show it for the rest of the world as well.
Yeah, I think that's what a lot of people think, especially in biathlon. But we saw that between January 2014 and 15, you didn't do any races. And Patrick Oberegger, he told us that in Norway, it's hard to survive if you don't show like the results, because there's no financial support from the army or the government like there's in Germany, for example. So has that also been a problem for you at that time to deal with the financial support?
Yeah, of course. It's a different system in Norway when most of our salary comes from private sponsors and bonuses and, of course, doing races and salary during the, or from the IBU regarding the races. So when you're out of training, out of competition, it's difficult to survive in an economical way, I can say. And this year, I wasn't living actually a luxury life. And you know, in Norway, it's so many biathletes knocking on the A team's door or the B team's door. So if you lose one athlete, someone else will fill that spot pretty fast, pretty immediate. So it's not a big crisis for like the federation to maybe lose one guy, lose one girl, because they know, okay, there are so many good athletes that will have the possibility to take this place. So I was mostly living on my parents' money, and, and I have a really, really eager and motivated dad who has been with me all the time since I was 8 years old. So it's like, it's not only my dream to become the best in the world, but also my family's and his dream. So he's sacrificed a lot for both me and my sisters. So we should be successful in sports. So I think I have a lot to thank them for, that I still are here, because without their support, without their economical support, I couldn't afford to still fight, to still train for this A-team World Cup spot when I was working my way back, because it was maybe from the age 22, 21 until 25, I made 10,000 euros a year. It was not much.
Yeah. Especially in Norway, right?
Yeah, especially in Norway, where, I mean, it's expensive. For example, the prize money from IBU are, I think they are not worth the same in Norway as, for example, another country. So it was some, not difficult times, but I couldn't enjoy life as much as I wanted to.
But when talking about that, are there any bonuses in Norway for you, like for the good athletes with good results?
Then I would say no, there are no bonuses. But every year we try to negotiate with our federation. So now we get the relay bonus that the federation gets from IBU. If we win the relay total score, then this bonus, this total sum, goes to the athletes. So I guess like when you win the Nation Cup, the federation gets some money. If you win the Relay Cup, these team cups, and this bonus we get from the federation, I mean, it's around 5,000 euros, I think, if we win both the mixed Relay Cup and the...
You have to share that with every athlete?
No, it's 5,000 euros per athlete. Oh, so I guess... Okay. Total sum is a lot bigger, but that's our bonus. So we, like, for example, in the Olympics, it's zero bonus.
Yeah, same in Germany.
And the World Champs or World Cup, it's no extra bonuses from the federation or any. Maybe you have some, if you have some private sponsor that you have your own bonus with, but nothing for, that's the same for everyone.
Okay,
Vettel. Then let's jump back to your results, to your first single-digit rank in a World Cup race. Do you know when and which race that has been?
I guess you have more control of the statistics than me.
It was in March 2017, the pursuit in Kontiolahti, where you ranked 8.
2017.
And Pfeiffer won that race.
Okay, it was pursuit, you said?
Yeah.
Okay, I had no clue.
okay.
But did that feel like some sort of turning point for you, that you knew you could fight with the best?
When you say it like this, now I think I remember the race. Yeah, this was after the Olympic tryout in Pyeongchang, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. Because we came from Pyeongchang for this test Olympics.
Yeah.
I remember I felt so good in Kontiolahti, and I had this amazing feeling in my body. I just could, my speed was better than ever before. And I think that that spring, like the races, the PyeongChang races was pretty good in 2017. The Kontiolahti races were pretty good. So that was kind of a turning point for my physical shape after the period of sickness and training I had prior to the sickness, that maybe I'm back now. Maybe I feel light. I feel lighter than ever before. And I didn't make it to the Olympics in 2018, but the 2017-18 season, I was training together with the B team again. It was my first season again back with the Federation after 2 or 3 years together with this private team. And the coach I had at the B team, we were doing some really good stuff, doing some changes in the training, doing some changes regarding the mentality, the physical mentality compared to the shooting mentality. And the year after, I was back with the A team again. So yeah, that's you were absolutely right that that 2017 spring was kind of a turning point for me, where I really, really could believe that it was possible to get back in amazing physical shape again. Because of course you always believe in yourself, but you need some good answers, not only in training but also in competition. So I think you know me better than I know myself. Sounds
like that. I mean, the next winter, the winter 18-19, that was your first full World Cup season. You were 26 years of age at that time. And I think that was your breakthrough season in international biathlon. You reached 4 podiums, including a win in Soldier Hollow. And that first World Cup victory, is that always a special one for you?
Yeah, I mean, I remember almost all the races that season pretty good. It was a lot of ups, starting in Hochfilzen with the third place at the Pursuit. I think shooting clean. Forkad on top, Pfeiffer on second, two big idols of me, and I'm on third place. Pretty good day. And then continuing with, I would say, very surprisingly win in Soldier Hollow. Looking at the altitude, looking at the course, everyone says this is the toughest course combined with this altitude we have in the World Cup. And as a big athlete, you know, 193 height, not almost 90 kilos. It was not supposed to be my favorite arena, but then I got the clean shooting, and I mean, I had so much respect for the track. I started so slowly, and I think after 1.5 kilometers, Vettle, you are 20 seconds behind Johannes. He was missing like 4, 5, 6 times that race, and I was going out with the clean shooting and battling Simon Destieux on the last loop and managing to take this win. It was emotional. I was crying a lot and remembering all the tough days the last 3 or 4 years. Suddenly it's all worth it. It's a pretty pretty special feeling that one day, like, or not only one day, but 30 minutes can be worth 3 years of work. It's that is why I continue doing biathlon, because this feeling is extraordinary. It's not always about the win, but it's about this feeling to feel that, okay, I've achieved something I've dreamed about. It can be winning, it can be medals, it can be top 6, but I feel I did my best and I made it for myself. That it was a quite okay day.
Okay.
Yeah, and that year you also became first time world champion in the mixed relay and also with the relay. And in the mixed relay, there are always starting the two strongest guys of a team. So how was your feeling after you heard that you will start in the mixed relay?
Yeah, I remember this quite well, because it was quite a discussion in the team. Should Tarja go or should Vettle go? Tarja didn't race in the North American races. He tried to find his shape by racing European championships. So when I got the message that Vettle you go, and we think you should go the last loop, because then we can use Johannes' skills better on the third leg. I was a little bit in shock, but as an offensive guy, I remember I said, yeah, I agree, I could do this last leg pretty good. I'm inexperienced. This is my first World Championship, but yeah. And that was the first race in that World Championship, if I remember right, the mixed relay. But yeah, yeah. I trusted in my ability mentally, and of course my sprint. And I remember Benidol, he was like 15, 20 seconds behind me for the whole leg. And it was quite tough to find the balance between pushing in the track, because I know how good of a skier Ben is, and I'm still wanting to have some good legs on the last shooting. But I think it's top three of the best races I've done, because it was such pressure. And you know, Benny hunting me all the way, my first race, my first really important last leg, and to manage to shoot clean and doing the race perfectly, it was, when I look back, I find it that was quite impressive. I think I impressed myself, and to finish or to have this last leg and ski the last 100 meters as the winner, it was a long lasting dream from my childhood to do this last leg. And since that day, it's been some quite nice experiences with this last leg, I must say.
But you also must have been quite nervous before the race, right? If you get that position.
I'm not less nervous than other guys. It's just maybe I trick the viewers to that so they think I'm not nervous, but I was very, very nervous. And I remember it was 2-3 days before that we decided that I ski the last leg, and it was some troubling nights of sleep, to be honest. But worse was the relay in Pokljuka some years after, when I did the last leg in Pokljuka, because then I hadn't done any World Championship races in Pokljuka before the relay, and we decided like 10 days before the relay that okay, Vetle, you go the relay anyhow, how the other guys do in the individual races, you do the last leg, and we don't tell anyone. We wait until the start is there, and that was some heavy things to deal with, like for my head to go there day after day, and having the press asking, yeah, what are you doing here, how are you making your days go by. I know that I will go the last leg, but I can't tell. So I had some tough mentally work you have to do when you prepare for these last standing shooting last legs. So I think there's a lot of work for only some minutes of racing that you have to do. It's like it can be days, it can be weeks, it months, years with preparations in your head to deal with those kind of situations.
Interesting, but I think that was a good transition because in 1920 you were the fourth best Norwegian and looked like a safe spot for the relays at the World Championship races. But in 2021, there came Stjøle and Johannes Dahle, and you were only the fifth Norwegian guy in the team, and in Pokljuka also at the World Championships. So you only started in the relay and the must start because you had a fifth spot there. And I imagine that these times must have been pretty tough for you, right?
Yeah, of course. It's tough to be. I mean, I think I was going into the World Champs in Pokljuka. I was number 12 or 13 in the overall total score, and I'm feeling that I'm a pretty decent biathlete, but it's four guys that's better than me just in the Norway. So it's pretty tough when some younger athletes come and steal your spot. But
yeah,
I mean, when you are in this circuit for a long time, you just, I get used to it. Like it's it's always a competition about something. It's competition for the gold medal. It's a competition for the medals. It's a competition for qualifying to the World Championship, qualifying to the World Cup, qualifying for the A team. And
yeah,
we get so used to just fighting each other that it's just a normal feeling for us to fight or challenge some of your best friends and your biggest competitors in Norway. It's like the same thing. Your best friends are also your biggest competitors. So it's tough, but we are used to it, and we talk about it. And I think all the guys are pretty chill about it as well. That there's no hard feelings when a teammate grabs your spot for the world champs or for the team.
But did that situation have any influence on your upcoming season?
Of course, it's when you are not allowed to do the races you want because you are not good enough and you only have yourself to blame. It's no one else's fault. Yeah, it got some anger in me. Okay, mm-hmm. I remember before Pokljuka, the preseason before Pokljuka, I've changed something in my training philosophy. I wanted to do some more skating because, okay, I want to be better biathlete, and we skate, we shoot, so I think I must skate a lot more. yeah. That didn't work out. So it's like it's the logical thought that you have to train a lot for what you're supposed to be the best at. That's the logical thought. But so before Pokljuka, I did a lot of this, skating, shooting, a lot of biathlon training, and it was quite disappointing that I didn't raise my physical, especially my physical level, the way I wanted. So after that season, I had a long discussion with my coaches, Siggy and Egil, and I said, I need to really take a step. It's cool to be among the 15 best biathletes in the world, but I want to be among the three, the five, the yeah. some of the on the top. I want to have this feeling I talked about before. This I want to feel to have this feeling more often, the feeling of success. So we looked a lot of my training the past years. We took a lot of tests, like inside my body, in my muscles. How did my muscles look? Where did I have a lot of muscles? Where did I have less muscles? And what can we do to customize my body to be the best biathlete I can be? So I got a lot of motivation from not being kicked out of the team, but kicked out of the World Championship team. And I started running a lot more. You know, I was a big guy, and maybe I had too much muscles, too much more than I needed to ski fast. So I got a lot of motivation in changing my way of training. And I think in the last 2-3 years, this is the key why I became, from the 12th, 15th best biathlete in the world to being fourth in the overall score last year. So I'm happy that I like that Dahl and Stula came to kick some new thoughts into my head, and finding out a better way for me to become the best, because not everyone cannot train the same. We have different body, we have different DNA, and we have different height, different weight, and so on. So I think I really figured out, I used a lot of time thinking, and I really figured out what should I do to become the best. And that's because Sturlanda came and were so good. So I have to thank them for being that good that year.
Okay, so they made you better. And yeah, you showed that last season. You struck back. You had a pretty good start in Östersund with your second World Cup win. And you slipped into the yellow bib for the first time and developed into a serious contender for the big Crystal Globe. And that was a totally new position for you in biathlon. So what has this position done to you, Vetle?
Yeah, it was quite a surprise for me. I think that I wore the yellow bib. I've always looked at myself as quite quite an up and down athlete.
Mm-hmm.
One day I can be among the best in the world, and the next day I can be among the worst. So it was quite a surprise to see, oh, I can be pretty, I can have some steady results. I can be good week after week. I mean, that's why I've set the goals that I did this year to fight for the overall total score. It will not be easy, but I mean, it shouldn't be easy.
Yeah.
That's one thing. I mean, everyone dream of as a biathlete. The overall score is very important for us, and I think we put it up there together with a gold in the Olympics or gold in the World Championship. So last year I was very surprised that I could do good races, race after race, even if the Olympics were the main focus last year. Because okay, I think just last year everything went out as planned. I had to be in good shape in the beginning of the season to qualify early for the Olympic team, because I was not sure I was going to make it among the four best Norwegian guys. You had Tarjei, Johannes, Sturla, Johannes, Dale, Erlend. It was and Philip and Sivert coming up as young guys. It was
crazy.
It's just quite tough to qualify for the team. So yeah. I had to be in great shape from the beginning, and I have to sacrifice some other World Cup races and maybe not be in my best shape there and focus more on training. And I think everything went out as planned. I qualified after the first World Cup in Östersund, and I had some other good races before Christmas, and then I could focus more on training in the Christmas time and in January, going a lot to Lavazze, training in the altitude. And Beijing was, after all, quite successful. And so I'm not expecting the same flow this year, but
okay.
I'm allowed to hope, yeah. I think.
But when we remember your performance in January, you had a little breakdown. So were you afraid that you would not get in shape for Beijing?
No, I was pretty... confident that I would get in shape, because doing biathlon for a lot of years, it brings also a lot of experience, and I think I'm starting to get this experience knowing how to get in shape. So I felt okay. We are a lot in the altitude, we are training a lot, my shooting was also dropping, and maybe this is also affected by the general energy that, I'm a little bit tired all the time and doing both some tough races and some tough training in the altitude. So no, actually I was pretty confident that after Antols, when I start resting, I go to Lavazze, taking some days off. I thought, this will be great. I've done everything as we planned. And if I do that, I have to be confident and satisfied with my preparation. So, yeah, I was pretty sure that the shape would be good in Beijing, and it was some ups and downs regarding the shape. It was some tough races. It came some snow, some low air pressure, some humidity that made it really tough competing, but the shape was as good as I hoped it would be.
And after all the preparation, you arrived finally in Beijing for the Olympics. And in the mass start, you took your first individual medal with the bronze. And you also got two, now three World Cup wins. Vettel, what's more special for you, the bronze at the Olympics or a World Cup win?
Oh, that's a good question. I think the bronze in the Olympics was, of course, very, very special. How it turned out, like I was 26th or 27th after the first shooting. And I came there on the last shooting on, I had target number 8, I think, or 9, and I managed to shoot clean in these crazy wind conditions. It makes it pretty special. I must say the race was maybe the most special race I've finished, and when it turned out with the bronze, it was just amazing. But feeling wise, like the feeling I had, I was mostly very, very cold after the mass start in Beijing, and you know, without our usual audience and without this scenery and loudness we are used to, I must say that the feeling I had, for example, in Otepe was a lot better, the feeling inside my body. And that's what counts the most for me. And when I'm talking about this, I must just mention one cool thing that last season, when I had the most crazy feeling I ever had, and I must say the best feeling I ever had, was I think I was five or fourth or maybe third in one race in Annecy before Christmas. It was either the Mass Start or the Pursuit. It was one of those races.
The Pursuit, and, yes.
Yeah, Pursuit. It was a quite good result, but I was not winning. But when I was there at the prize giving ceremony, and I think it was Jacquelin or Quintin on top, and one of them were second, so it was double France.
Yeah.
Well, normally, it's some of the audience, they go home when it's prize giving ceremony, and it's not so loud, but there everyone was still having their seats, and the stands were full, and there was prize giving ceremony, everyone happy because France won, and then they start singing the national anthem. It was no one starting it. It was just the audience starting to sing, and nothing on the speaker. It was just the audience, and that gave me some crazy goosebumps to just be a part of that show. And I mean, yeah, that was one of the best feelings I ever had as a athlete, standing there to feel this inside my body. It was fourth, third place, quite good, but not the best. But to experience something like that, that's for me, that's what's matter, and that's why we love this and can continue year after year, because we get so many good feelings, not many good results, but kind of this feeling. So that was I hope for the same this year, double twice, France on top, and then I can take third place and they can sing it. That will be my main goal for this season.
Okay, so it will be in Annecy-le-Gravenant, I think. But Vettel, there was another final shooting, because with the World Championships at Pokljuka, you established yourself as the new final skier for the men's relay in your team. And you showed some really impressive last shooting duels in that season, but also here in Beijing, of course, in the relay. So can you take us with you to that relay race in Beijing where Johannes exchanged with you?
Yeah, I mean, talking about the Mass Start was a special race, but where do we start with the relay? That was one of the most crazy races I've not only been a part of, but watched. Like, it was such a roller coaster of emotions, with Sturla missing and having to do a penalty loop. Tarjei didn't have his best day on the second leg. And then, I mean, our tactics with putting Johannes on the third leg and me on the fourth, it really played out in Beijing, because then you could see how good of an athlete Johannes is. Yeah. And how much he can do on the third leg when he doesn't have, for example, Jacquelin taking his back and benefiting on having his back, that he can still follow Johannes even if he's a bit weaker cross-country skier, because it's easier to ski in his back. And Johannes catching almost a minute on Russia, changing with me. I think my main focus was to battle France and Germany, because it was the fight for the medal. One of us had to be number four, the worst position, especially in the Olympics. I mean, that was my main focus, because 1 minute till Russia, it's too much. I never thought about the gold medal, so I tried to, I remember Quintin, he was starting really tough. I think he wanted to benefit his shape, and he knew that me and Philip maybe couldn't catch up with him if he was as strong as he was before that that Olympics. So I remember, I thought, save some powers here, try to glide it in a downhill, use your weight downhill to catch the gap, and don't be stressed if Quintin makes a gap uphill. And we went for prone. I felt calm, I felt good, so it was just five ordinary shots, still the same distance till Russia, and Philip, Quintin, and me were still together in the second loop, and then going behind the targets for standing shooting. Quentin was really pissed because I think neither Philip or me really wanted to do the work. We knew he was the best cross-country skier among us, and I think we both thought that, okay, it's okay for all of us if Quentin leads the group and we are second and third. And he was really pissed, and he tried to ski really, really fast. And it was just about being calm. Don't be aggressive because of his aggression and reaching standing shooting. I think I was watching, Latipov is still there. It's three targets still black. I was, this is the chance of my life. It was black. I remember nothing. It was so quiet at the stadium because we didn't have the normal German chair. It was no Russian, no French people there cheering for them. So it was so quiet. I could clearly hear Quentin and Philip hitting and missing. And I thought, okay, now I've heard Quentin missed once and Philip missed once. I knew that. And I had four clean shots and I was pretty nervous and I was shaking, but I just decided to take it early. Take it. And the fifth was also a good shot. And the adrenaline I was going out on the last loop with, it was something else, because you work so hard to don't feel anything when you shoot. Like, you should have no emotions. You should just be flat to have a normal heart rate and to don't get nervous. And then when you go out and you have a clean shooting in the Olympics, probably knowing you're going to win against all odds, how it turned out at the relay, then the adrenaline is doubling, tripling. And it's, it was just a really, really amazing feeling.
Yeah, thanks for sharing this amazing and interesting memory from you. But I mean, it always looks so easy when watching you. Do you have any special thoughts when you're coming to a final and also decisive shooting?
I mean, it hasn't always been like this. Even if as a young athlete, I dreamt about skiing this last leg, being the main person going with the flag over the finish line. And I really wanted this feeling as a kid. I think many does. It's a natural feeling. But I think it's something I've developed over the years, that I try to don't take myself or the competition so seriously. I try to have a little bit more fun with it. I try to joke a little bit with my teammates before the start and the other fourth leg guys. I try to talk a little bit normal, just trying to put on a good show. And I mean, I have so much respect for both the difficultness it is to stand there on the last shooting, and respect for the other fourth leg athletes, that I just feel lucky that I'm a part of this show, that I can be here doing the fourth leg. What is the alternative? The alternative is staying home, and that's not a good feeling to stay home. So I rather want to be here and shitting my pants than being home and don't have anything to do, or at least don't do biathlon. So I just think I feel very privileged to be in this kind of situations, because you know, that in the end, that's what every biathlete dream about, to finish up the relay team and to stand there at the last shooting, even if it's individual or relay, to just be there and fight. So I think now I have a very, very just natural and calm feeling regarding this team, that it's just all fun, and I will win sometimes and I will lose sometimes. Now I've been very lucky, and of course have had some skills to win most of the duels, but I know it will come tough times where someone's for sure going to beat me, and all calm about it. It will happen sooner or later.
Okay, yeah, but last season it went quite well for you, so it was the best season for you, right? Two wins, fourth in the total score, best shooting statistics for you, and also best skiing for you. So did you change anything this summer?
Yeah, actually I started right after the Olympics changing some things, and I immediately got some good results because I changed some things at my gun for the prone shooting, because I had some good percentages at prone shooting. I was a good prone shooter, but I felt it could be more comfortable. I could have a better feeling. So I changed some length on some things on my gun to get a better feeling on this arm sling here. I forgot it was a podcast. You can't see when I'm showing.
Yeah,
true. I made the arm sling longer to make it clear. So I started right after the Olympics, and I shot some really good prone shooting after the Olympics. And this summer, I haven't done any special changes on my position or my gun regarding the physical training. I've kept up the good work with a lot of running and perhaps even more than last year, that I've tried to push the boundaries even more. I'm running approximately 35 hours a month, and that's pretty much when you think that it's skiing and skating in the winter. So I tried to keep up that good work. And of course, it's the first season after an Olympics. It's a bit different because a lot of things happened in the Olympics. It was 3 years with preparations for the altitude, for the COVID situation, for the ice cold conditions, for the wind. It was a lot of preparation. So we were tired after the Olympics. So now we started like our new 4 year. A block of training. So we trained less tough this summer. We tried to take it a little bit more calm, with a lot of hours, a lot of volume, but not so high intensity. So like we've slowly started the new Olympic period and preparing long term for Antols. But surprisingly, I would say I feel better than ever before. I've had two rounds with COVID-19, one in the spring, one in the summer. So okay. I had some weeks off training. But with the years, I've been a pretty wise guy and learned to take it easy when I'm sick. So so the shape is quite good, even if we didn't do our normal tough periods with the intensity training.
Sounds good. But then tell us, what can we expect from you in the upcoming season?
You can expect the best. I like to be honest, and I'm not afraid to talk loud about my goals. And I want to be the best. It's simple. I want to be the best biathlete in the world, and I want to win the Crystal Globe. I mean, it's going to be a hell of a fight, because it's some very, very good athletes out there, not only from Norway, but I think Sebe will be strong this year. We have some French guys, and I expect maybe Philip to be even better than he's been before. I think he has some potential he hasn't shown yet. So thinking about that, and you add Sturla, Tarjei, and Johannes in the count, it will be tough. And I must say, I think Johannes looks very, very strong now, and a lot of stronger at this time of year than he did before. He now, with his situations with family and a kid, he used to be a little bit a slow starter, and he really is there for the World Championships and the big races in January, February. But he showed some really good speed on the skis already, and it will be tough to beat him.
Yeah, but maybe he will miss some speed in the end. You never know when he's so early in such a good shape.
Yeah, I know. And shooting, of course, is important. And to have this high quality on shooting every race, I think I can be a little bit better than him there. So we'll see. It's going to be an exciting season. That I can promise.
Okay. And looking at the World Championships in Oberhof, we thought that your best rank in Oberhof was an 8th place in the Master 2020. So will you go for the medals there, or what's the deal there?
What can I say about Oberhof, this big Steig? It's not designed for me. For me, I can say. But that's what I thought about racing in Soldier Hollow. It was not a track designed for me. And suddenly I take my first win there. So never say never. Of course, I have high hopes for the World Championships. And I want to leave Oberhof with an individual medal and the relay goal, which always is a big, big goal for our team. But I have to be honest, I wish the big Steig was not there. But... I will attack it and try to do my best.
Okay, so 2 weeks ago we saw you in Schön, and you seem to be in a pretty good physical shape. At least your skiing was quite good in both races. So the question is always, what does it mean for Kontiolahti? How meaningful are those races in Schön?
I mean, they are meaningful in one way, and that's getting the training for the race mode, like. Having the preparations for a race, having the audience, having the C-ring, having the bib, and stuff like this. Your shape is not the most important, but gives some confidence to leave the opening races with a good physical shape. I think we are pretty used to turning bad shape into good shape in some days or some weeks, so it's not a big crisis if we're not in shape. For okay. This Schön race, especially when it's 2 weeks until Kontiolahti. Now, only 1 week. But for me, it was good to see that I could keep my roller ski shape at the snow, especially when it was such challenging conditions not much snow, and it was 50 centimeters with sugar snow. It was challenging to ski the way I wanted, and to be able to be this fast, it was a good sign for the weeks to come.
Okay, mm-hmm. Rettler. So at the end, we got a little section that we also want to do with you.
Rapid fire.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the name. That are questions that we always ask our guests. You can answer in just one word or sentence. Rettler, do you have any ritual before the start of a race?
If I have a ritual, I have... thousands of rituals.
Really? Yeah.
I think every athletes get these crazy, stupid rituals through the years. It's something about just doing the same over and over again. And when you do one thing and you do good, you think, that's because I did that small thing before the start. But I've started and quitting with a lot of different rituals, but. The one I still use is taking my poles and touching them against each other, both in front of the body and behind myself, just to wish myself good luck, or I don't know why I do it. I'm crazy.
Okay. So what's your favorite World Cup venue except of Oslo?
Oh, my favorite World Cup venue is Rupolding, because I think it's the only place I've had the best course time is in Rupolding, and I just love the track. I love the shooting range. It's always good conditions, and of course the atmosphere, the German fans, and it's a lot of Norwegian fans, and they are always on the first row. So when we go out for the start in, for example, the relay or the mass start or pursuit, where we have to go to the start, saying hello to the Norwegian fans on the first row. And I think every year it's some thousand Norwegian fans there, and we feel really like home in Rupolding.
Your favorite racing format in biathlon?
My favorite racing format is pursuit, because I love to just use other athletes' backs to save some energy and don't do the work myself. I have to say pursuit. And I don't know, pursuit before mass start, maybe because pursuit is 2.5 kilometer less. I think I love the short.
Okay.
Prone or standing shooting?
I mean, I think I'm a better standing. I have to say standing, because standing is more a mental game, and prone is more technically with your position and stuff with your trigger, and standing is more more rough, more mental, so I choose standing.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
What is the coolest thing about biathlon for you?
The coolest thing is I have one saying about biathlon. It's like Miley Cyrus or Hannah Montana said, it's the best, if you know her.
Yeah, of course. Of
yeah.
course. the best of both worlds, the best of a physical fight and a mental fight where you have to do the total opposite of what you've just done. Like, you have to ski for life and then you should be calm as hell. It's like two way different things, and that's what makes it so interesting, both for athletes and fans.
Okay, and what annoys you the most as a biathlete?
Oh, that was a good question. What annoys me the most? I think when I have planned to have a slow, easy morning, sleep until 10 o'clock, and then the doping controller knocks at my door at 6 in the morning. And maybe I've just been up at 5:55 peeing and I'm totally empty. I sit there and I have to drink for 1.5 hours to pee again. That's important work, but I don't love it.
Yeah, well, that's something okay. new. Never heard that, yeah.
Vettel, until this point in time, what was your favorite moment in biathlon?
I would my favorite moment. I guess we've talked about a lot of my favorite moments.
Yes.
Of course, I can't say anything else than the relay in the Olympics, because striking back from this, being almost 2 minutes behind and then be able to win it, I think, in the same time remembering how difficult it is to succeed in just this moment. You have one chance, one opportunity, and then we were able to take it. Now it was like the Eminem song.
Yeah, yeah, yes.
it was one shot, one opportunity, and would you take it? And then it was yes. It was I feel very, very, very lucky to have been able to experience this.
Okay. So do or did you have any role models in biathlon or outside of biathlon, maybe other athletes?
Yeah, for sure. Ole Einar Bjørndalen was a big, big role model for me. And it was watching the Olympics in Salt Lake City. I got really, really hung up in biathlon. I was 10 years old in 2002.
Yeah.
And that got me totally addicted into biathlon, and so for biathlon I have to say him. And I'm a big, big fan of football, Liverpool, and Jurgen Klopp. I love him. his mentality and his way of working with his players, his combination of kindness and strictness, it's a really good way of coaching athletes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, of course, the Germans, right? So,
yeah.
But now you can put together your best biathlete in the world, and it doesn't matter if she or he is active, inactive, a man or a woman. Which attributes would you take and from whom? Like the shooting from X and Y, and you know, and so on, or the character from this guy or this girl?
I would go for the. Okay, I take it. I break it a lot down now to take a really specific. Attributes, that shooting speed for sure, Simon Edder, I choose him there. Standing shooting, I would say Marte Olsbu Røisland. I think her abilities is good.
Yeah.
Standing mentality, I go for myself.
good.
Standing with the pressure. Prone, a good prone shooter. I think Hanna Öberg is a good shooter, but I mean, she's the best in. I have to go for Simon Edder in prone shooting. I think he, as well as his shooting speed, he has some really good percentages. So I choose Simon Edder. For the skiing fitness, like overall skiing speed, I go for Johannes.
Yeah, of course.
the sprint, I go for Fabian Claude. I think.
Oh, yeah,
that's good. Yeah.
If I'm eating in the sprint. I'm afraid. I mean, I'm a good sprinter myself, and it's my dream to meet Jacquelin or him in the sprint. But if I meet Fabien and he still has some powers after the race, I'm afraid. So I choose him. So that's my dream athlete and my dream to finally meet something in the sprint, someone in the sprint.
Okay, okay.
Okay, Vettel, so the last quest of today is, imagine you had a big billboard in a big city. Everyone can read it. Which message would you write on that billboard? And it shouldn't be a commercial.
Okay, then I would write maybe something I think about when I prepare for the mental stressness at the last shooting, that it's not so important if you fail. And I think that Billy Eilish said this, that you're soon going to die and no one's going to remember you. That's a bit negative to write, maybe, but it's like, it's a big, big world and no one really cares if you fail, and you don't have to be afraid to fail. I think it's going to be okay.
Okay, yeah, I think that are perfect final words to conclude this episode. But Vettel, tell our audience where they can find or see more about you if they want to do that.
Yeah, I'm pretty active on Instagram, trying to be funny. So if they want to follow me there, they can, and have a good laugh. Sometimes I try to not take myself so seriously. So jump in on my Instagram account to laugh with me or off me. It's okay, it's both.
Yeah, I think it's nice. Vettel SC, right?
Vettel SC is right. And I have a really weird profile picture, so you can't really see it. But I'm living in the future, so maybe you don't know what it is, but soon you will.
Okay. Like Elon Musk. So thank you very much, Vettel. And it was very interesting to get those insights into your mind and your thoughts. And maybe we see each other again or speak each other again. So wish you the best and goodbye.
Thank you. It was a pleasure from my side as well.
Thank you. Bye.
Goodbye.
The answer seems to be that you have to enjoy those last shooting duels, Hendrik. But I think it was crazy to hear that he really blacked out on the last shooting in the relay of Beijing.
Yeah, and I'm keen on seeing him doing that more often this season, because, Ron, that are the special moments in biathlon for me.
Yeah, for sure, Hendrik. Right now, the season started quite okay for Vettel, with 19 hits in the individual and a 7th rank. But I gotta say, his skiing shape in Shishun looked a little bit better, so there might be some room to improve for him over the next weeks, or maybe next days already.
Yes, but you also got another victory in the relay, so maybe that will give him a little performance boost for the next races this weekend.
Yeah, maybe. We'll see, Hendrik. But for you out there, what do you think? Will Vettel come back in the sprint and in the pursuit this weekend? I mean, last year, he won the pursuit in Östersund, the first pursuit.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe on Sunday, he will come back again, Hendrik?
Yeah, maybe.
So that would be interesting to know. Just write it under the Instagram post of this episode. All other informations of Vettel and of us can be found in the show notes. And if you liked this episode, then follow us on Spotify, iTunes, or wherever you are listening to this. And you can help us if you give us a 5-star rating on your podcast app of choice. And it's even better if you share that with the biathlon world, with your friends, with your family, whoever is interested in biathlon.
Yes, I have nothing to add here. So, Ron, that's it for today.
Yeah, and for all the Germans out there who are listening to this episode, we are back on Monday with another German episode, of course, for the English people. I'm sorry, but we are a German podcast, but we also enjoy these English episodes. So stay tuned for more and see you next time.
Ciao.